to the world, the lost will be found, and freedom will live is when we cry out. You carry the cross, you died and rose again. My God, I only ever give my all. And you say, your son, from heaven to earth, and you deliver us all. What's eternally heard? Ask us for truth, but all I found was you. My God, I only ever give my all. Jesus, we're living for your name. Take it all, take it all. Searching the world, the lost will be found. In freedom we live is when we cry out. You carry the cross, you died and rose again. My God, I only ever give my all. And you say, your son, from heaven to earth, deliver us all. It's eternally just for truth, but all I found was you. My God, I only ever give my all. Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you. And our praise and all we are today. Take it all, take it all. Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you. And our praise and all we are today. Take it all, take it all. We're running to the one who heals the blind, following the shining light. In your hands the power to save the world, my life. We're running to the one who heals the blind, following the shining light. Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you. And our praise and all we are today. Take it all, take it all. Jesus, we're living for your name. We'll never be ashamed of you. And our praise and all we are today. Take it all, take it all, take it all. I will follow wherever you lead me, wherever you are underneath these stars, sure I won't be. And I will lay down this old life of mine. I'll leave behind all the things of the world just to follow you. And I'll be strong and courageous. You're my Feels like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. And all of a sudden, I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory. And I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. Jealous for me, loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. And all of a sudden, I'm unaware of these afflictions eclipsed. Oh, how he loves us, how he loves us so. Yeah, he loves us, oh, how he loves us, oh, how he loves us. Oh, and of my honest shame, though, of a childlike faith, and of my honest praise, and of my honest shame, though, of the holy life, and of my sacrifice. Jesus, we thank you for this day. God, I ask that we would truly take this time to find that hiding place in you, that we would get rid of distractions, and we would take this day to just remember who you are, remember how big you are and strong you are, and that we can hide in you when we need to, and you invite us to every moment to come to you, and I thank you for that, Lord. Help us to do that today. Help us to really focus on your word this morning, and help it to change us and make us more like you. Have your way in this service. In your name, amen.
Thank you, Whitney. And welcome to Grace Fellowship Online. Glad to have you in my living room again. And hopefully someday soon we'll be able to see each other in person again. But we'll just be happy that we have this technology for now. A couple of announcements. Number one, Men's Fellowship is going to be tonight at 6 o'clock. Make sure that either Chase or Bob know that you're wanting to attend. And anybody that's watching, wherever you're watching from, if you're watching from out of state, you're a man, you're a Christian, want to fellowship with other men, you're welcome to join our Zoom fellowship. Just get a hold of Bob Daglish or Chase Douglas. Also, ladies, you're having a Bible brunch without food on Saturday. Is it 10:30? 10:30, and let Evelyn or Whitney know that you'd like to join that, and they'd be happy to send you the link. And I'm excited that we're getting these things going. Pretty soon, also, we're going to be having a grief share group, and you can talk to Ed Anderson about that. And that's also going to be this summer on Zoom, but just to get your, you know, if you've lost a loved one and you're just maybe having still a hard time dealing with that, this is a small group that you can get some help, but also, you know, share each other's burden. So it's a really good group, and I recommend it highly for those of you that are grief-stricken. And Jesus said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they will be comforted." And that includes you. So think about that. And right now, let's think about our friends that haven't yet come to know Jesus. Take out your friend-to-friend card. And let's pray for our friends, and let's pray for ourselves as we open up God's word this morning. Lord, thank you for our friends that haven't yet come to know you. Thank you for how much you love them. And thank you, Lord, that you have a plan. It says in your word that you're devising a plan to bring them back to you. And so we ask that you would implement that plan. And if we're part of that plan, Lord, we're available. So use any means necessary to bring our friends into your kingdom. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And Lord, we thank you for your word. We ask that as we open it up, that you would help us to open up our hearts to not just hear words, but Lord, to hear from your spirit. And Lord, give us the desire to obey you and to become more like you. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Open up your Bibles to John chapter 18. Excuse me for the cough. Allergies are just kicking my rear end. How about you? Yes. But we're going to go on anyway. John 18:15. Simon Peter was following Jesus, as was another disciple. That would be John. That disciple was an acquaintance of the high priest, so he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Peter remained standing outside by the door. So the other disciple, the one known to the high priest, which we all know as John, went out and spoke to the girl who was the doorkeeper and brought Peter in. Then the servant girl, who was the doorkeeper, said to Peter, "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" "I am not," he said. Now the servants and the officials had made a charcoal fire because it was cold. They were standing there warming themselves, and Peter was standing with them warming himself. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. "I have spoken openly to the world," Jesus answered him. "I have always taught in the synagogue and in the temple where all the Jews congregate, and I haven't spoken anything in secret. Why do you question me? Question those who heard what I told them. Look, they know what I said." When he had said these things, one of the officials standing by slapped Jesus, saying, "Is this the way you answer the high priest?" "If I have spoken wrongly," Jesus answered him, "give evidence about the wrong. But if rightly, why do you hit me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They said to him, "You aren't one of his disciples too, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, said, "Didn't I see you with him in the garden?" Peter denied it again. Immediately, a rooster crowed. So, I've been told by a lot of people that have done certain things that God wouldn't ever forgive them. And here we find Peter doing something terribly wrong. Peter denies Jesus, denies ever knowing him. As I read this, I'm reminded of another guy who did something worse. And his name is Judas. He did something that I think, matter of fact, I know that he thought was unforgivable. He turned Jesus in to be crucified. Today, the teaching is entitled "The Tale of Two Men." And let's read about that second man in Matthew chapter 27. We're going to read 1 through 5. It says, "When daybreak came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people plotted against Jesus to put him to death. After tying him up, they led him away and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, was full of remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. 'I have sinned by betraying innocent blood,' he said. 'What is that to us?' they said. 'See to it yourself.' So he threw the silver into the temple and departed. Then he went and hanged himself." See, both of these men betrayed Jesus at his most difficult hour. One ends up committing suicide, the other doesn't. And we're going to look at the difference between these two guys. We looked at Judas last week, but we're going to say, what is the difference? One man hangs himself, the other guy doesn't. And the reason we're going to compare these guys is so that the many who struggle with misdeeds of the past God wants us to have his perspective on these things and not to focus on our misdeeds of the past. See, people have a very difficult time with condemnation. And you see here, when condemnation is fully extended into a person's life, you see what happens. That would be Judas. I'm sure that Peter had condemnation. See, both guys are remorseful over what they've done. Now, Judas orchestrated his. It was premeditated. So some might say, well, that's worse. I don't think there's any sin that's worse than another one. Worth than another one. First day with the new lips. But both of them are remorseful over what they did. And truthfully, it's important that we confess our sin and realize that we've done wrong. There's so many people, you know, blame shifting in our society these days. Nobody will admit that what they did was wrong. And yet that's the first thing that we need to do so that we don't get caught up in condemnation. The worst thing that you can say to somebody these days is that they're wrong. So I can disagree with somebody agreeably. Can you? Yeah, we have a lot of people, a lot of friends that we disagree with on certain subjects. And what do? We just don't really talk about that subject, because we know it's not going to lead to anything positive. But there's some people that just simply won't admit that they're wrong when they are proven wrong. Therefore, there's not help for people like that. Both of these men actually realized their sin. And the thing is, Judas went to the people that you would think you could confess your sin to, and they would help you. But they didn't. They said, yeah, that has nothing to do with us. You do something about it yourself. So he did. And what was his solution? He went and killed himself. Luke 22, 61 and 62. Then the Lord turned and looked at Peter. This is right. This is like, you get the impression, this is the second after the rooster crows. Or maybe even during the rooster crowing. The Lord looked at Peter. So Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. Was Peter remorseful? Yeah, he was. Is just being remorseful enough? No. We have to do something with that remorse. We're going to find out in a little bit. Peter does what he needs to do with the remorse. Judas doesn't. Matthew 27, verses 3 and 4. We just read this, but I'm going to read it again. Then Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus had been condemned, was full of remorse. So scripture says he's full of remorse. Is it good enough to be remorseful? No. And returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood," he said. What is that to us? In other words, they're saying, who cares? He goes to the priests. The priests are supposed to be the spiritual leaders in the country. He goes to the priest, and the priests look at him. He tells them the problem. They say, who cares? Is that what a priest is supposed to do? See to it yourself. So he does. 1 John 1, 8 and 9 says this: "If we say we have no sin, we are deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Does that leave anything out?
No.
It doesn't leave anything out. See, we think I have I have the special sin. My sin is so unique. My sin is so special that it can't be forgiven. So you don't understand. God understands, and right here in the Bible, it says, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How many of you, and I know I can't see you, but I can imagine what your answer is. How many of you would say that even though Judas's sin was horrible, if he had confessed his sin to God, if he had confessed his sin to Jesus, would Jesus have forgiven him? Would Jesus have forgiven him?
Yes.
Yeah, he would. Because if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's the God that we serve. That's the God who has forgiven us. And I'm so thankful for the forgiveness of my sin, aren't you? You know, because of that, we can enter into God's presence, not just when we die. See, people worry too much about, oh, when I die, by and by, in the sky, you know, whatever. I know Jesus right now. I can walk into his presence right now. And that's, to me, just as important as the fact that when I die, I'm going to stand before God and I'm going to hear those words just like you are. Well done, good and faithful servant. Yeah, I can't wait to hear those words. It's going to be great. But you know what's just as great? When I have a problem here and now, I can walk into God's presence now. Because of what Jesus did for me on the cross. And I can confess that, and what I'm really confessing is this, God, my thinking is messed up. Because I was thinking that this thing had some value in my life, and I really find out now it's sin. It's an abomination to you. It's something that's an insult to you, God. And I was thinking that it had some value for me. But it doesn't. It's evil. And I confess that I have sinned. And he says, I forgive you, son. Proverbs 28:13 says this, the one who conceals his sin will not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them will find mercy. Get it? Confesses. Just being remorseful is not enough. We need to renounce whatever it is that we're doing. Psalm 32:5. Then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not conceal my iniquity, as if God doesn't know already. I will confess my transgressions, things I did on purpose, to the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave me the guilt of my sin. God will forgive us even for the things we do on purpose. So, Judas, unfortunately, allowed the conviction of the Holy Spirit to become condemnation. You know, the conviction of the Holy Spirit is God, you know, kind of making us feel a little bit guilty about what we're doing wrong. It's the thing in our spirit that indicates that we did something wrong so that we can confess it to God. Because sometimes in the beginning, how many of you have been saved for a while and you go through several years of being, you know, of walking with the Lord, and then he points out something that you've been doing the whole time but didn't realize that it was wrong and says, I need to deal with that in your life now. Did you have any of those things? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Me too. I bet you have if you've been walking with the Lord for some time. And that's the thing. The Lord is sanctifying us as we walk along. But if we're not careful, we can let that conviction of the Holy Spirit become condemnation. How does that happen? Well, it happens because we get convicted, we feel guilty, and instead of letting the Lord help us with that problem. See, the Lord never points out something in your life that he's not willing to help you get rid of, right? He's not saying, Don, this is nasty. You just get rid of it right now, or you're gonna get it. No, he's not doing that. Judas let the conviction, which he could have simply confessed to the Lord, he let it become condemnation. And that, you know, he let it be that God was condemning him. And therefore, he was condemning himself. He felt that he didn't deserve forgiveness. He would not receive forgiveness. He wouldn't even ask for forgiveness. You might say, well, how do you know all that? By what he did, what did he do? He hung himself. He didn't go visit Jesus in prison and say, I'm so sorry, I threw the money back. I didn't know what I was doing. I don't know why I did that. Would you please forgive me? And you know what Jesus would have said? I forgive you. He didn't give Jesus that chance. I would have loved to have seen that story in the Bible, wouldn't you? The ultimate act of forgiveness. We almost see that story. But what Peter did is not really the same as what Judas did in the eyes of people. Romans 8, 1 and 2 says this, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus, because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. So are you in Christ Jesus? Are you in Jesus? Is Jesus in you?
Yes.
Yeah? There's no condemnation for you. There isn't. We don't need to walk around feeling guilty about something we've already confessed to the Lord and changed our mind about. See, the fact that you feel guilty about it kind of makes me feel like you probably realize it's a bad thing. Because you wouldn't feel good, you wouldn't feel guilty about a good thing that you did. How many of you have given something to the poor before? Can I see your hand? Do you feel guilty that you helped the poor? No. How many of you have gone and visited somebody in the hospital? Do you feel bad about visiting that person in the hospital? I mean, even if it wasn't a good visit, do you feel guilty about visiting that person in the hospital? No. How many of you have ever helped feed hungry people? Do you feel guilty about that? No. Why? Because it's not a bad thing. And you know it's not a bad thing. How many of you have felt guilty about sinful things that you've done in your life? Yeah. That shows me that you realize it's bad. And we need to go to the Lord, confess that, and let him help us stop doing those bad things that we have the propensity to do. Move down in Romans 8 and move all the way down to verse 31. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? In another translation, which I like better, it says, who can be against us? The answer to that is no one. Anybody bigger than God? No. He did not even spare his own son, but offered him up for us all. How will he not also with him grant us everything? Or the things that we need is what he's talking about. Who can bring an accusation against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Whenever you see that word justified, think, just as if I'd never sinned. That's how God sees you. Just as if you'd never sinned. And he's not like family, knowing that you've sinned and saying, I forgive you, but secretly hiding it back there in the back of his thinking, and every time you walk in the room going, he's not doing that. My dad did that. My heavenly dad doesn't do that. Because when he forgives, it is just as if you'd never sinned. Boom! Everything starts over again. I think that's cool, personally. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died. But even more has been raised. He also is at the right hand of God and intercedes for us. That means he's acting as our lawyer. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Can affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Rewrite this question this way. What is it that can make God stop loving me? Does persecution mean that God doesn't love me anymore? Does affliction, does famine, does nakedness, does danger, does sword, or AR-15, or Glock? No. Those things don't mean God doesn't love us. We have difficulties in our life, and we have talked about those difficulties ad nauseum recently, so we don't need to go over it again, but God uses those. He doesn't cause them, he uses them though. And says, as it is written, because of you we are being put to death all day long. They are being lit up as Roman candles by Nero. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. All what things? Affliction, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword, AR-15, Glock. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Bottom line, God loves you. Nothing is going to make God stop loving you. You may not believe this, but up until he died, God loved Osama bin Laden. God loved Osama bin Laden. We don't know if he did, but I really doubt that he turned his life over to Jesus. But that was God's will for him. Up until the very end of his life, God loved Hitler. God loved Stalin. God loved Saddam Hussein. Up till the very end, God doesn't give up on us. And he doesn't stop loving us. Not just those of us that have followed him. The reason Jesus got on the cross before you ever repented of your sin was because he loved you. Did Jesus just start loving you after you repented? No. He loved you the whole time. And he's the one that was drawing you into his presence. Do you think you're the only one? No. No, those terrorists out there. God doesn't like what they're doing. But he loves them. And he would like them to do what you've done. He would like them to repent. There are people in our society doing all sorts of evil in our world today. But you know what? God still loves them. He created them to be his children, just like he created you to be his children. And you know what? Judas didn't understand this concept. And so instead of feeling guilty for years and years and years and years, is what he thought he was going to have to do, he just ended it right then. See, we can always go to God through Jesus and ask forgiveness and find mercy. Peter actually received the forgiveness of Jesus. It's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Sorry, my allergies are making my nose itch. Peter received the forgiveness of Jesus. He probably thought that he didn't deserve forgiveness. That's why he ran out of the courtyard weeping bitterly. He realized what he had done. He had denied his friend, probably his best friend, denied ever even knowing him, simply because he was afraid. But the thing is, he didn't run from Jesus when he had the opportunity to run from Jesus. He went to Jesus and allowed him to forgive his sin. See, I know people that, and you can watch this in the character of your friends if you want to, because it's not very uncommon. I watch people and I see them, and all of a sudden in their life, they're running away from God when they used to run to him. And it sort of tells on them. Not necessarily every one of them, but I would say 99.9% of them. They've done something that they know God doesn't like. And instead of running to him and asking for forgiveness, they run as far away from him as they possibly can, making excuses to everybody that they know. Because, you know, we all notice it. You can't just be worshiping God one day. You know, every time church is open, you're there and, you know, oh, hallelujah to you, praise the Lord. And then all of a sudden, you're not there. And people say, hey, are you all right? Oh, yeah, I'm fine. I'm good. Everything's cool. Everything's not cool. What that person needs to do, in case you know a person like that, they need to go to Jesus. And we need to encourage them to do that. See, you know, in our life, we have a very simple mission. And that is to bring people to Jesus. Not to bring people to us. I'm such a great counselor. People need me in their... No, people need Jesus. And my job is to get out of the way and bring people to Jesus. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The blonde girl gets it. But Peter received forgiveness simply because he didn't run away from Jesus and hang himself. He could have. I'm sure that tree had room for Peter on it. But he didn't do that. Luke 22, 61 and 62, then the Lord turned to Peter. And Peter remembered the words that he had said, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. That's repeated over and over and over again in the Gospels. So what does that... Well, he was remorseful. That's important. But it's not the end of everything. Look over at John chapter 21. Spoiler alert. John 21:15-19. When they had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And more than these, he said, "Do you love me more than these other slobs that are my disciples too?" "Yes, Lord," he said to him, "you know that I love you." Now, first thing that I want to mention about this is if Peter, and if you didn't know, a lot of times in the Bible, people were called by two different names, and Simon was Peter's first name, Peter his second name, and after he started hanging out with Jesus, he decided to be called by Peter or Cephas, which means rock and is the Hebrew of that. But the thing that you need to understand is Peter was eating breakfast with Jesus. And Judas didn't even give that a chance. Judas just took away any chance at all that Jesus could forgive him. Because he didn't think he would, didn't think he could, didn't think he deserved it. I'm sure Peter didn't think he deserved to be forgiven, right? But the one smart thing that he did is when he saw Jesus on the shore cooking fish, he jumped out of the boat and swam to Jesus as fast as he could. And they all had breakfast together, and after breakfast, Jesus asked him this question. And Jesus answered him, "Feed my lambs," he told him. A second time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," he said to him, "you know that I love you." "Shepherd my sheep," he told him. So he asked him, the first time, Peter probably isn't thinking anything of it much. You know, "Simon, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, you know I love you." Second time, Peter's like, "Why is he asking me a second time?" But he answers him, "You know that I love you." 17th verse. He asks him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved that he asked him a third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." See, he's not quite catching it yet. But he's upset now. The second one didn't quite push him over the edge, but the third one did. Having to confirm to Jesus that he loves him, and he's grieved. He's upset that Jesus would ask him the third. Did you not hear me the first two times? Don't you believe me? You know everything. And Jesus does know everything. When you're having a conversation with God, God knows what you're going to say before you say it. But I'll tell you this, you need to say it. Don't just assume, well, God knows everything, he's just going to fix it. No, you know, prayer is powerful. And we need to talk to God about the things that we want him to help us with. I mean, he already knows it. I was going to say the things that we want him to know. Duh, he already knows it. But we need to ask him to help us because he's a gentleman. And without permission, he's not going to step in and just run over your life. And I think that's a good thing. Sometimes in my life, I'm thinking, God, here would be a good time if you just stepped in and ran over everything. But he doesn't do that. He waits for us to ask. That's why it says, keep on asking and it will be given to you. Well, I don't want to really annoy God. You know what annoys God? Is when we don't ask. When we don't talk to him. What, you know, it's not much of a relationship if we're not talking to him about what's going on in our life, right? See, right now, my mom is in an assisted living place. She's having some problems remembering and you know, all kinds of stuff. So conversations are strained. Because number one, she's stuck in that place, and there's really nothing new going on for her. So, you know, she watches TV. If any of you during this quarantine have been watching TV, TV is lame. Right? There's only so much TV you can watch without starting to go a little bit nuts. And so all she can do is sit there in her chair and watch TV. The exciting time of the day is when food comes. So we call her every day. But the conversations are strained. And they're really short because there's... I'm stuck in the house. I'm a high-risk person. So I haven't left the house except for one doctor's appointment since this whole quarantine has gone on. Because I don't want to be a statistic. You know, even when I was feeling like I might need to go to the emergency room, I didn't want to go to the emergency room. There's too many germs in the emergency room. So I wrote everything out here, talked to my doctors over my computer or on the phone. Conversations are strained. But we try to let her in on everything new that's going on. So that, you know, we can have a decent conversation with her. It's important that we have a conversation with her. That's what relationships are all about. My mom wants to know what's going on in my life. I want to know what's going on in my mom's life. Unfortunately, right now, it's pretty much the same thing. She's sitting in her recliner. I'm sitting in my recliner. Watching lame stuff on TV. I'm rewatching shows from years and years ago that I've seen. You know how lame that is? Can I use the word lame more? Should I use it like three or more times? Lame, lame, lame. There's nothing exciting to talk about except right now, this is the most fun I have all week, talking to you. Because I get to talk about the most exciting person in my life, and his name is Jesus Christ. So Peter really wasn't getting this whole thing. And Jesus says to him after he says, Lord, you know everything. You know that I loved you. I love you. Not loved. I used to know how to read. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Truly I tell you, when you were younger, you would tie your belt and walk wherever you wanted. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will tie you and carry you where you don't want to go. He said this to indicate what kind of death Peter would glorify, by what kind of death Peter would glorify God. After saying this, he told him, follow me. That's special. There's a couple things special about this, but just to get to the last paragraph, Peter died by crucifixion, just like Jesus. What was he doing in the courtyard of the high priest? He was denying Jesus so that he could get out of being crucified. And Jesus is telling him, you know, when you were younger, you could do whatever you wanted to. But when you get older, Somebody's going to tie you up and take you where you don't want to go, and you're going to stretch out your hands and be glorified. Tradition goes that when Peter was being crucified in Rome, he asked them to crucify him upside down because he didn't feel worthy to be crucified in the same manner that his Lord was crucified in. Now, whether that's true or not, I don't know. But that's what the people that are supposed to know tell us about Peter. The cool thing about this, how many times did Peter deny Jesus?
Three.
He denied Jesus three times. How many times did Jesus ask Peter, "Do you love me?"
Three times.
I don't know him. I don't know the man. Cuss. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. And he concludes this conversation after three denials, three confessions of his love for God. And Peter's right. You can tell God, "I love you," all you want to, and he knows whether you actually do or whether it's just words. Have you ever had a person tell you that they love you and you know that it's just words? Unfortunately, I've had too many of those in my life. Jesus knows. Sometimes people told me they loved me, I believed them, and later on they proved that they didn't. But Jesus does something I think that is really special right here. He ends the conversation with two words. They're the same two words that Derek Jeter, we're not talking about the Yankees, that Peter heard first from Jesus. Follow me. Follow me. He's restoring Peter right back to the beginning. So all of you that are sitting there going, "I just need a second chance," here it is. Jesus wants to restore you right back to the beginning and give you that same calling that he gave you at first. Before you ever blew it, follow me. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you that, like we talked about on Wednesday, you will not always accuse us. Like these guys did stuff, like Judas turned you in to be crucified. And Peter denied that he ever knew you. And you said, if we deny you before men, you'll deny us before the Father. And yet, Peter received forgiveness. Judas would have received forgiveness if he'd hung around that long. No pun intended. But Lord, today we confess our sins to you. Thank you that we can confess our sins to you and our transgressions. Lord, help us not allow the conviction of your Holy Spirit to become condemnation in our life. Help us to reject condemnation because of what you did for us on the cross. And Lord, allow us to receive your forgiveness. And just like Peter, help us to be totally restored to you. With everybody's heads bowed and their eyes closed, how many of you would say today, you know, I need that restoration. I've been running away from God because of certain things in my life. And I need to run to Him so that I can receive restoration just like Peter did. If that's you this morning, even though I can't see you, God can, Jesus can, would you simply lift your hand up and put it back down so that you can look back later in life and say, that's the day that I gave this problem to the Lord and received His forgiveness and stopped walking in condemnation and guilt and shame. Anybody else? Before we pray. Lord Jesus, I thank You for everybody who lifted their hand. Lord, we do come and we confess our sin to You. Lord, we've been running away from You and we needed to be running to You. Lord, we need help straightening out our lives. And we just haven't asked. Lord, we confess our sin to You. Confess your sin to Him right now. And Lord, we ask that You would forgive us of our sin. And that You would help us to walk in righteousness. Help us to know what the righteous path for our lives. What is that righteous path? And Lord, help us to walk in freedom because You have restored us. And help us to build Your kingdom from now until we see You face to face. We thank You for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, don't forget men's fellowship tonight at 6. And make sure that you get a link from Bob or Chase. And if you don't know how to get a hold of them, go to our website, gracefellowship.net, and click email the pastor, and I can get you their information. God bless you. See you on Wednesday.